SQL query is now clear, how simple and elegant it is. There is no harm in using either of the forms, as I said. So natural join schema, as I mentioned, will not be all of this. This particular column will be removed. And don't ask me which one, this or this. It doesn't matter really, because both are exactly identical. It only happens that one comes from one table, another comes from another. Now, are you convinced that the relational algebra is powerful enough and a strong enough mathematical foundation to give you the basis for extracting information from either one or multiple tables? If you ask me, the basic SQL is just this. There are a whole lot of things which we shall now discuss more formally, because there are lots of other features. But fundamentally, the ability to extract information from one or more tables in a database based on a very sound mathematical elegant theory is what is so beautiful about relational databases. All the databases which come out of relational model are called relational database. They are called relational because they are based on relational algebra, which incidentally is based on the relationship between multiple things. Okay. Theta join, we'll just discuss it very briefly, it is not much relevant. Theta is any meaningful predicate. So you put a natural join operator here. This is the way you demonstrate theta join. You put a natural join operator here and put a theta as a predicate. You don't require a predicate to be defined for natural join. But when you put a theta, it means that this is something like natural join, but not exactly as strong. It is a diluted version where theta usually has a join condition. So for example, theta is student.sroll equal to range.sroll and SCPI greater than 9 and SH equal to 8. Now this technically would be described as a theta join. Although you could always say that this is a natural join followed by a selection. Select star from student comma range where student.sroll equal to range.sroll and SCPI greater than 9 and SH equal to 8. If I had written this as select star from student natural join range where SCPI is greater than 9 and SH equal to 8, I would have divided this query into a natural join and a select predicate. Both would be equal. There is one question though. You remember we mentioned about efficiency. We said that SQL query does not require us to define in which order what should be done. It figures it out. Can you guess how exactly this operation would be carried out? Suppose I had said select star from student natural join reg where SCPI is greater than 9 and SH equal to 8. Or alternately, I would have said select star from student comma reg where student.sroll equal to this and this equal to this. Will it do a cross product? Very obviously, the answer must be no. If actual cross product has to be performed, the machine would be dead. So it will do some elegant operation. Will it do an elegant operation to do this join first and then apply this criteria? Or it will first do the selection? Remember, if there are 5,000 students and if there are 30,000 registrations, then I will not get 30,000 into 5,000 as a cross product, but I will get 30,000 elements in that join. Natural join will have 30,000 elements. It is obvious that all 30,000 elements are not relevant. The number of students who stay in hostel 8 itself is 250. Those of them who have CPI greater than 9 is maybe 5. 5 students on an average would have registered for 6 courses each, 30 courses. So not 30,000, but 30 courses only need to be done. Why not then I first select these 30 jokers from the student table, not jokers, nice people, and then form a natural join of these 30 people with their registration records? That would make a lot more sense, right? There is an element in the modern database management systems called query optimizer. Professor Sudarshan will describe it later. In fact, Professor Sudarshan's real global expertise is world's leading researcher in query optimization. A query optimization takes this query from you, the database engine finds out what are the possible alternative ways of answering this query. These are called query plans. And then selects one which costs minimum. Cost is in terms of disk accesses, computational time, etc. All that is taken care of. Imagine as COBOL programmers, if we have to do it, we have to do the thinking as to what will be the most optimal way of doing it. So that's another important component of the database management. So is this clear? The queries, natural join? Okay.
Sir, I wanted to, myself, Imlesh. Hmm. Sir, in natural join, it is, it has to be based on primary key only.
It has to be based on common attribute. As we shall see later in the database design, invariably the common attributes will be part of either the foreign key or the primary key, as we shall see.
My doubt is, if the attribute is same, but right, the name differs in the other.
And that is what you have to take care of during the design. Okay. In fact, one of the reasons why you may still use this form, student.srole equal to reg.srole, is because if this is prole, then you have to say student.srole equal to reg.prole. Natural join will not recognize it.
Okay,
The common name should be common. In fact, that's the reason why, you remember I mentioned data dictionary? The data dictionary should be having a unique set of attribute names across the entire enterprise, so that there is never any confusion. Given an attribute name, it means exactly the same thing in whichever table it has been used, unless there is a student name, teacher's name. But T name for teacher name, if you put anywhere in your enterprise, T name should mean teacher. Oh, whatever. So that's of course a design issue. But you are very right. So please remember, natural join, I forgot to emphasize this, natural join depends upon the requirement that the schema contains the same name for the common attribute. If it does not, then you can still prescribe natural join, but you will have to give the expanded version of the natural, this older version of that. Right.
And it has to be primary key.
It need not be primary key. For example, in Reg, SROL is not the primary key. SROL plus C code is the primary key. In student, SROL is primary. Invariably, when you join multiple tables, one of them will be a primary key and the other will be an element of the primary key in the other table. But it's not necessary. In the other table, it may be just an element. It need not be a part of the primary key also. In one table, in the student table, SROL is the primary key. In reg table, SROL is not the primary key. In reg table, SROL plus C code is the primary key.
No, that's what I'm asking. Basically, it picks up a primary key from a table and then...
No. It doesn't pick up anything. This is what you are prescribing. This is the beauty is that, you see, okay, this is a good point. He is still thinking in the standard algorithm. That's a problem with all of us. When we write programs in conventional programming languages, we think as the computer thinks. So we are thinking what the computer would be doing. Okay. When you write SQL queries, you have to keep yourself miles away from the computer. Never bother about what the computer does. Mathematically, none of them are required to be primary keys. Any common attribute name, if they mean the same thing, natural join can be done. However, in 99.9% of the cases, you will not get any meaningful information. Other way around, if you want to extract meaningful information out of tables, obviously those tables will be related in some way. The relationship is more than likely to be only on those fields, one of which is the primary key in some table. But it is only likely to be from a semantic point of view. Mathematically, the relations don't distinguish. It cannot be. More than one attribute in the same table cannot have same name.
No, not in the same table.
Huh.
More than one attribute in two different tables are having the same name. Then how natural join is going to recognize
it? How can it be same name?
Sir, what suppose SROL and SNAME have defined in one table, SROL and SNAME in some other table.
Then the natural join means SROL here should be equal to SROL, SNAME here should be equal to that SNAME.
It will take all the...
That is the difference between natural join and theta join. Natural join insists on equality on all common attributes. Whereas theta join, you can relax that condition. Right. Okay. So now we begin a sort of formal study of SQL. Already only 15 minutes left. Okay, let me see how much I can complete. This is supposed to be only an introductory part. Professor Sudarshan has promised that whatever I leave, he will carry on from there. But the idea is to, I think with this information alone, you should be able to play around with the machines today. Some schema has been prepared. Amit, the schema is there, right? And you will give them an introduction to NetBeans. So you may take some time to become familiar with NetBeans, which is a development environment. My suggestion is on first day, don't spend too much time in investigating nitty-gritties of NetBeans. Just understand that as an environment, how to log in and how to invoke SQL through that NetBeans. Then they have defined some schema, you have populated some data there. So you will give them some printout of the schema or something. Yeah, yeah. So my TAs are they are IIT students, so they presume that people will remember a whole lot of complicated things in their mind. We are all grown-up people. You are kids, so you can remember things better than us. It would be nice if the schema is printed on a piece of paper and is circulated. Wonderful. So you will have that schema, and you try to run these queries, you know, just to see what happens, what you get. Have fun today, basically, but learn as much as is possible. So here is a formal introduction to SQL now. For this, we have given some relations. These are relations from Professor Sudarshan's book, so you can correlate directly to. Here is the account relation, which has an account number, a branch name, and balance. So branch name is like our LIC branch. Account number is like our policy number. Of course, there is no equivalent of balance, but there is a balance amount in the account. This is one relation. Here he defines attribute types. So this is a formal definition. Each attribute of a relation has a name. The set of allowed values for each attribute is called the domain of the attribute. This is a formal mathematical name. Attribute values are normally required to be atomic, that is indivisible. So value of an attribute can be an account number, but cannot be a set of account numbers. We already discussed this. Domain is said to be atomic if all its members are atomic. It's only a mathematical clarification. The special value null is a member of every domain. So you say grades are only A, AB, BC, etc., etc. By mathematical definition, null is a possible value. Okay. Indicates that the value is unknown. The null value causes complications in the definition of many operations. We shall ignore the effect of null values in our main presentation, but we shall discuss these later. Relation instance. So a relation schema is one thing. Relation instance is the current values of a relation specified by a table. So this is a table. Jones, Main, Harrison, Smith, North, Rye, Curry, North, Rye, Lindsay, Park, Pittsfield. This is customer name, customer street, customer city. These are attributes or columns, and these are tuples or rows. An element T of R, R is the relation schema, is a tuple represented by a row in a tuple. It's only a mathematical definition of whatever we discussed. R is the relation schema and T is an element of the relation. So T and R are now being distinguished. We so far talked about relation, relation schema and the values in the same breath. But relation schema is R, the relation itself is the relation instance. Any one row in that relation is a T. Okay. Order of tuples is irrelevant, very important. In COBOL, we distinguish between sorted and unsorted phi. Mathematically, the mathematics of relational algebra doesn't give a damn on how the relation elements are stored. So this may be A101, A215, A102, A305, doesn't matter. It just doesn't matter. This is a relation. In fact, in a database also, it doesn't matter how the rows are stored in a table. Because ultimately, it's the expression for extraction that you give which will determine what is to be extracted. Mathematically, a relational does not require sorting. Okay. So account relation with unordered tuples. This is an example of that unordered tuple. A database consists of multiple relations. Common sense. Information about an enterprise is broken up into parts, with each relation storing one part of the information. Here, we have account which stores information about accounts, depositor, which stores information about which customer comes with, owns which account, and customer stores information about customers. Very clearly, account and customer are two independent entities, and depositor is some kind of a relationship between these two entities. Similarly, there could be a loan account or something like that. There I could define other things. The normalization theory of how to get the best set of tables to describe a database, there is a theory called normalization theory. We shall have a hint at the normalization theory on fifth day, the last day of our course. I will again come back on the last day where we will discuss this and the performance issues that I mentioned, and this will come from the seventh chapter of the book. Normalization theory is an exquisite mathematical theory. We need not understand the entire mathematical theory, but we need to understand what we call functional dependencies and the first, second, and third normal forms, which are fundamental in any database design. Here is a customer relation. So here is a customer name, customer street, and customer city, something like address and city. Here is a depositor relation. You can notice that depositor relationship is like that reg, course code and student number, customer name and account number. So this is the relation. Same customer may have multiple accounts. Johnson has two accounts. Keys. I will omit this. This is nothing but a mathematical definition of keys. If you recall, we discussed super key, candidate key, and primary key. Those of you who are mathematically inclined, you can say let K be any subset of R. What is R? R is the set of attributes. It's the relation schema, not the relation. R is the set of all attributes, say 10, 20, 100, whatever. K is a subset of R, which is a super key if values for K are sufficient to identify a unique tuple of each possible relation R on R. R is a schema. Remember, if I change, add, subtract, I get a new relation. So I will have a series of relations R. R1, R2, R3, R4, all defined on R. For any such possible relation, if these K values are sufficient to uniquely identify a tuple, I call it a super. In plain English, a super key is nothing but one which uniquely defines a row in any relation. Okay. By possible R, we mean a relation R that could exist in the enterprise we are modeling. Example, customer name, customer street, and customer name are both super keys of customer, if no two customers can possibly have the same name. Just an example. In real life, an attribute such as customer ID would be used instead of customer name to uniquely identify customer. You can see it's exactly the same reasoning, but we are mathematically defined. K is a candidate key if K is minimal. Since we are now talking in terms of set theory, K is nothing but a set of attributes. If K is minimal, means if some key is super key and no subset of it is super key, then that is a minimal super key. Subset of super key means any subset element. Primary key is a candidate key chosen as the principal means of identifying tuples with a relation, should choose an attribute whose value never or very rarely changes. That's the reason why combination of room number and hostel number is not a unit. Or employee code, etc. So email address is unique but may change. Never use it as a primary. Foreign keys. This is an important concept and a concept which will be very relevant in most of our database activities. A relation schema may have an attribute that corresponds to the primary key of another relation. This attribute is called a foreign key. Go back to our old relation. In the reg file, if you visualize the reg table, in the reg table, roll number plus course code is the primary key. But that roll number is also called a foreign key because that roll number refers to the roll number of the main student table. Similarly, the course code is a foreign key in the referring to course table. What is the importance of this foreign key? This foreign key represents an association and it also defines a very stringent condition which actual entries in my table must satisfy. Namely, unless a student is registered in the student table, the registration record should not appear in the registration table. Unless a course is approved by CNET and finds a place in my course table, no student can be permitted to register for it. Similarly, here if you see, customer name and account number attributes of depositor are foreign keys to customer and account respective. Exactly the same situation, customer table and account table. And the depositor table is nothing but the two common primary keys. So they must refer to this. Here is a schema diagram. Here is a branch. So let's look at just the customer and the branch. Customer is here. Branch is here. Account has, the depositor has customer name and account number. The account number refers to an account which has a branch name and balance. And in here, the branch name refers to this branch. Okay. Just look at these two relations, account and customer. The primary key of depositor is both of these. Account number is the foreign key within the depositor table which refers to the primary key of account. Customer name is the attribute of depositor which is a foreign key referring to customer name of the customer. So, is the notion of foreign key clear? Foreign key is that attribute of a table which refers to primary key of some other attribute of some other table. Now this will answer your question. Since a natural join is effectively the same thing, and since most meaningful information out of cross product can only come because of the relationship, and since the relationship is defined by foreign key, which essentially maps into a primary key of something else, there will be some primary key in the join. Query languages is a generic term, language in which user requests information from the database. COBOL program is a query language, but it has to be specially written. Ordinary user cannot write it. So there are procedural languages or non-procedural or declarative languages. There are pure languages. Relational algebra is a pure language. That means it's a complete mathematical structure. Tuple relational calculus is another equivalent but more powerful way of describing the relational operations. The SQL incidentally implements features of both, as we shall see. Domain relational calculus is another form of calculus. Since algebra itself is sufficiently complex for us, after all we all left math, not me, but most of you left maths long time ago, and calculus will be a difficult thing, so we'll not get into that. But those who are mathematically inclined, there is discussion on both the relational algebra and the relational calculus in this. However, our main purpose is to acquaint ourselves with the power of databases and the practical use, so it won't be required. The reason I am emphasizing this is the beauty of relational database is the fundamentally sound mathematical foundation on which the whole thing is based. Pure languages form underlying basis of query languages that people use. Here's the history of databases. I already mentioned IBM SQL language developed as part of the SystemR project at the IBM San Jose Research Laboratory. It was renamed Structured Query Language. Instead of SQL, it was called SQL. ANSI and ISO standard SQL came in these forms, 1986, 89, 92. The next standard was not called 99, but 1999. Jokingly, people said that the language name itself became Y2K compliant. So four-digit year number. And then SQL 2003, which is the latest standard. Commercial systems offer most, if not all, SQL 92 features, plus varying feature sets from later standards and special proprietary features. So for example, when LIC decides to use a database to take, let's say, a corporate license, we should obviously insist on having as many as the latest features as possible. Although this is a relational algebra-based system and it's called a relational database, in consonance with the demands of the time where object-oriented philosophy and paradigm is used heavily in programming, object-relational features are being implemented in most databases, and many of those are standard of SQL 2003. So object features are possible in a conventional database language. The main part of the database management system, which permits us to define our tables, attributes, and schema, is called the data definition language part, DDL. DDL, DML, data manipulation language, and DCL, data control language, are the three components of SQL description. DDL permits you to describe your schema and other things. DML permits you to manipulate the data, which includes querying the data. So the SQL queries that we saw are all part of DML. DML obviously has other statements which will permit you to insert data, delete data, update data. And DCL, which is the controls thing, which we shall study later, which will permit you to define access control. So Pramod should be able to access some tables, but I should not be. Seema should not be able to access some view, but others should be, whatever. General control mechanism. Sorry, Seema, I didn't mean to prohibit you from accessing anything. These are the data types in SQL. You are all familiar with COBOL types. Picture 9-4, picture X something, whatever, whatever, whatever. Here are the data types. Let's quickly go through that. You can look at it in greater details later. Int stands for integer. It's a finite subset of integers which is machine dependent. So the largest value, etc., will be dependent on the machine. Numeric P, D is a fixed point number with user specified precision of P digits with N digits to the right of decimal point. Very much like picture 99V99 kind of. Please remember that COBOL is very special in this respect from other procedural languages. There is no mechanism to represent exact decimal integers and fractions to be represented. In all other languages like Fortran and C and all, you have conversion to binary system. COBOL permits that. The database also permits exactly the same. It permits char-n and var-char-n. Var-char-n is a character string with varying length. Maximum length is defined as n. Char is a fixed length string. This is naturally understood. N-char is another thing called national characters. Because char normally means one byte for one character. But you cannot represent many bytes, many characters like that. Japanese language characters will require 2 bytes represent. Unicode requires 8-bit representation, but it could be a 2-byte represent. If you want such thing, then you have to say N-char, also N-var-char. This allows 2-byte Unicode characters. So all Hindi, Devanagari, Telugu, Tamil, which are represented in Unicode now, can be represented by a 2-byte. Some people ask whether I can enter Hindi or Devanagari things into my present database. If I have defined that as char, I cannot have a Unicode representation. So I'll have to change it to N-char. Okay. Small int is a small integer. It's typically like 8-bit or 16-bit versus 32-bit or 64-bit. That's a minor variation. You can use that. Real and double precision are floating point numbers. Again, you are familiar with those. Float n is another representation of this, whether it's floating point where user specified precision of at least n digits is guaranteed. Theoretically, n can be even 100. And the language compiler is supposed to implement a 100-digit precision floating point number for you. But that is stupid. Nobody does that. A create table statement. And although the people will give you a schema, you should try to create your own schema and see how you could insert data or something like that. That should be possible through NetBeans, right? So the way you create table, you say create table, say branch. Branch name char 15, branch city char 30, assets integer, char 15 and then not null. This not null is a constraint. It's called an integrity constraint. It specifies that the value of branch name can never be null. So typically any such attribute which cannot be having null value, you have to say not null. The general form is create table followed by a relation name. So create table branch. Branch is your own chosen name for the table, like file name. And this is nothing but your FD entry in details actually, but with many more things prescribed. So A1 is the attribute name, whereas D1 is the data type of attribute. That is what must be minimally prescribed, like name and picture, minimum. But there are so many additional things which you can prescribe either here or separately through what is known as integrity constraints. So apart from all the attributes in the table, you can define a large number of integrity constraints later. These integrity constraints, we shall see in a moment, these are constraints which will guard against accidental damage to the database by ensuring that authorized changes to the database do not result in a loss of data consistency. For example, no two customer name same ID number. Branch name attribute of the account relation must contain a value corresponding to the actual branch in the branch relation. Student roll number in the reg must contain a value which is actual student roll. Foreign key. So foreign key is a constraint. A grade must be either AA, AB, BC, CD, etc., etc., but not ZZ. That's a data integrity constraint. These constraints can be defined at the level of schema definition when you declare a table. What is most important, once you define these constraints, no programming validation or check is required. The database engine, the SQL engine, will guarantee that these constraints will not be flouted. If any insertion attempt is made by any program through, of course, SQL statement, error will return. So try to insert a student record in the registration where the student is not there in the master database, the record will go back. Try to insert hostel number 39 against a student, the record will be thrown out. Try to update the value of the salary of a professor from whatever 20,000, 25,000 rupees to say 25 lakh rupees. If the maximum salary is defined to be salary between this range and this range, you have a problem. So this is something really, really important from a programmer's perspective. How many times you have found that somebody has forgotten to check something and that has resulted in the bad data in the file? Because human beings can forget. Here is a guarantee, you define a constraint, nothing can happen to your database. Okay. So integrity constraints can be of various types. The most important constraint is primary key. So for example, create table branch, branch name is so-and-so, branch city is so-and-so, assets integer, primary key is branch name. Here is another table customer, customer name, customer street, primary key in bracket customer name. So this is a primary key automatically means it is unique, etc. Is customer name as primary key realistic? No, we already said it should be customer ID or something. Referential integrity, we have already seen, it ensures that the association or relationship. So here is an example. The foreign key clause lists the attributes that comprise the foreign key and name of the relation referenced by the foreign key. By default, a foreign key references the primary key attributes of the reference table. So here is create table account. Account number CAR10, branch name this, balance this, primary key account number, foreign key, branch name, references branch. Here is a depositor account, is customer name and account number. Now here primary key is customer name, comma account number, foreign key account number, references account, foreign key customer name, references customer. There are many variations. For example, if the name of the primary key here is different from this, you can write references account in bracket that name. Theoretically, you can define a foreign key which refers to a non-primary key, in which case you can say that name. So all the details are available. If you don't say anything, then by default it refers to the primary key of that name.
I am Mahesh. This account, in the earlier statement, this any account number, you have stated that not null.
Yes.
But when you say it's a primary key, you are not stating that it's not null.
Yes.
So that indirectly means.
Yeah.
Indirectly, if the primary, then no null value will be accepted.
Correct. In fact, the primary key subsumes the requirement that it should be not null. So primary key implies that it is not null, it is unique. These two things are implied.
Inbuilt.
Yes. You may still have another column which is not null and which also is required to be unique. For example, a candidate key. But there is no statement in SQL which says this is my candidate key. So to prescribe candidate key, you say not null and unique as the two attributes. So this is clear. There are other integrity constraints. Not null is one of them. Unique is another. You remember we said distinct actually in the select statement, but in attributes, when you characterize, you say unique. So unique means these form a candidate key. Check constraint is a very strong constraint. Appears after attributes are declared. For example, check balance greater than zero. Now, I have a balance of 100 rupees and my wife goes and tries to withdraw 120 rupees. Any update request there will reduce the balance to minus. If this constraint is defined, that transaction will be thrown off. The check constraints are very generic constraints and you can put any kind of check constraint actually can be written as a SQL query also inside the bracket. Every time a transaction is done which affects that particular attribute, the entire query will be run. And if that query based on that condition, if it is satisfied, it's okay, otherwise not. So we will of course discuss more details on these constraints and how they are implemented later.
Sir, I'm Amit. Can we modify these constraints any number of times without changing the actual?
Yes and no. It's a very ticklish issue. Generally, modification of constraint reflects very poorly on the design. But yes, design can always be changed. And in fact, if you notice this, that's what I was discussing here. Drop and alter table. The drop table command deletes all information about the dropped relation. The alter table command is used to add attributes to an existing relation. Alter table R add AD. The alter table command can also be used to drop attributes of a relation. Alter table R drop A. Dropping of attributes is not supported by many databases. So you may want to define a new table, copy the contents of this table into that table and drop the entire table. Okay. In general, whether you can redefine those, that you cannot redefine the integrity constraint checks. What you can do is, you can temporarily dilute them. You can say for this particular operation, don't insist on these integrity constraints.
We may regularly need to, if some constraints is being expanded or something, we may require to redefine that constraint, or we may have to visualize that for long term we'll have to.
That is the reason why I said that if the total time spent in building a relational database based application is 1.5 years, at least 6 months should be spent in analysis and design. Invariably, people are very eager, particularly people like us who are programmers, you know, we are itching to dirty our hands on the terminal. Okay. In any professional software development thing, if without the complete documentation of the designed algorithm, anybody writes a code, that person would be fired. During learning, you experiment. You learn the tricks of the trade, etc. But formal system, never ever without design. Just like without adequate testing, will you release a version? You might because you are forced because of the circumstances, but you know the fun that awaits you there.
But the constraints also.
Yeah.
Design a system,
yes.
It is not that we are doing something hard coding, like the values are not defined in the constraint. Again, as you mentioned, that this constraint might be coming again from another select queries.
Correct.
So, some valid values, as you see in the plan. So, we will define a relation of plan and there you just go on updating the values.
Okay, we can have
In a, another relation, that will be taken. So, that's how you go on modify. It is not that every time you have to change the
just like the same
schema.
Principle, like you don't hard code things in your program.
Nothing is.
Similarly, you try not to hard code some of the business related constraints like that. That's a very cute way. Although purists will say that Pramod is cheating the system. But that's the way going forward because you require flexibility, but you still require those constraints. A curious question is you impose a constraint 6 months after the system is operational. The new values will be, of course, pertaining to that constraint. What happens to the old value? Think about it. Sleep over it and read the book to find out the answer. I will close this. I'm sorry, you're already late. But this one is an important thing. In any procedural programming language, including COBOL, temporal attribute handling is very difficult. Temporal means time-wise. Putting a timestamp, putting a date, putting a time, calculating date arithmetic, how much of Ghodagiri you have to do in your COBOL programs to find out what are the 3 days date after this date. Luckily, SQL takes care of it. There is a type called date which contains a 4-digit year, month and date. So this is a date example. There is a type called time and any attribute can be defined to be of the type date or of the type time or of the type timestamp, which is a combination of date and time. You have a interval which is period of time, for example interval 1 day, and if you subtract a date time timestamp value from another, gives an interval value, and if you add or subtract interval into a date, you will get another date, and that will be the exactly correct date. So half your Maramari problems are resolved. You can extract values of individual fields from date, time or timestamp. Here is a extract verb in SQL. Extract year from r dot start time. Or you are given a string value expression. You can say cast that string value expression as date. So these are some, now these are some niceties about SQL for practical pointer. There are large object types. One is called blob or binary large object, and the other is called clob, the character large object. Suppose you have a digital picture, 1.9 megabytes. But what are those? Those bits represent pixel values. A single pixel may be 6 bits, 8 bits, 20 bits, you don't. How many pixels are there, you don't know. You can't make sense out of those pixels. It's a blob. The interpretation of those pixels has to be left to a software which will interpret these pixels and show a nice picture on the screen or print a nice picture on the screen. SQL has nothing to do with it. So it is not a data type on which you can make comparisons or make relations or nothing like that. It's a value. So blob and clob permit this kind of a value. Whenever a query returns a large object of this type, usually a pointer is returned. And the interpretation of this value is left to some other program to which you must connect the output of your blob. But you can store blobs and extract them.